So welcome, and we're going to have a number of festivities today, but since it's honoring a great mathematician, the first thing we should do is have a mathematics talk. Fortunately, the man for the job is close at hand here. I'm happy to introduce Deputy Director Lamb, who will speak about CAP.
Is the mic on? Okay. It's a great honor to be asked to speak today. We are here to celebrate a very special occasion, as Carol says, CAP's 80th birthday, which will be this Saturday. Gathered here today is a very distinguished and most unique audience. We have Saunders MacLane from Chicago, Constance Reed from San Francisco, and other dignitaries. And we have members of MSRI who make the Institute what it is. And then we have all three past and present directors of MSRI, and in fact, all six past and present deputy directors of MSRI who are in this country at the moment. So to speak in front of such an audience is a thrill of a lifetime. My assignment today is to give a talk on CAP. And let me introduce myself as Progeny of Sweet 16. I'm sure this title needs a little elucidation. No, it doesn't mean that I am some kind of abandoned child. And it doesn't mean that I'm preoccupied with NCAA March Madness, neither of that. My supervisor is Hyman Bass in Columbia University, and he happened to be the 16th PhD student of CAP at Chicago. 5 years ago, when we celebrated CAP's 75th birthday, there was a gathering here, and Hyman was on hand to make some remarks. And earlier speakers have pointed out that CAP's many students are arranged in a chronological list, so everyone has a number. So when it was Hyman's turn to speak, he began by saying, so I guess I'm Sweet 16, so that's where this comes from, since I'm a student of Hyman. This brings me back to the days when I was working with Bass in Columbia University. I had the honor to be his first PhD student. 30 years ago, perhaps even in this month, I was finishing my doctoral thesis. So Bass took the initiative to call Kaplansky, his teacher at Chicago, telling Cap that he has a student finishing. So a couple of days later, I got a telegram from no other than Cap himself, who was chairman at Chicago at that time. And the telegram said, we offer you an instructorship at the University of Chicago. Your yearly salary will be $8,000. So now I'm sure you're not very impressed with this salary of $8,000. But let me remind you that we are talking about $1,960 here. At that time, as a little TA in Columbia, I was making $2,000 per year. So you can see that my first debt to CAP was that he quadrupled my salary. Actually, Bass never asked me if I wanted to go to Chicago. He just thought that it would be good for me, and he contacted CAP on his own. Years later, I came to realize how much that ticket to Chicago meant to my career. In Eckhart Hall of the Chicago department, spirits of long departed giants still seemed to hover around the place. E.H. Moore, Heinrich Maske, L.E. Dixon. So there I met my mathematical grandpa, Cap, who had just stepped down as chairman. And I met my mathematical great grandpa, MacLane, who had already made a trademark out of his famous neckties. In Chicago, they have this tradition of putting up skits performed by graduate students. This is a wonderful tradition, and I wish we had it also in Berkeley. It gives graduate students a chance to get back at the faculty for giving them B's in their courses. In these Chicago skits, you would invariably see a graduate student character storming on stage, sporting a wide and outrageously colorful necktie, and no one would ever have any doubt who that was supposed to be. So much about my Chicago days. Let me now talk a little bit more about mathematical genealogy. And this brings me to the so-called Kaplansky tree. One of Kaps' greatest accomplishments was the large number of PhD students that he has supervised in Chicago. So they and their graduate students and their students' students, etc., formed the so-called Kaplansky tree. This tree actually appeared in the notices in 1985, and it looks like this. So let me, it's in very small print, so let me just try to, so it looks something like this, set in two columns with many, many students. I counted a total of 235 names there, and this was only in 1985, and surely there would have been many more third and fourth generation students since then to be added to this list. Because it has been a span of 12 years. And this could easily make it 300 strong, or maybe even more, I don't know. So how did this tree get published in the notices? It was Saunders who submitted it as a letter to the editors of the notices. In order to trace the genealogy of Kaplansky tree, let us show a part of, this is a little too little. The pin is too fine to see, so I have a little enlarged version here that looks like this. So here are some of the well-known students of CAP, so Alex Rosenberg, Harold Widom, Sterling Barbarian. Pardon me? Oh, it's not showing the top here. Okay. Oh, zoom, I zoom it too much, so let me just zoom back here, back to normal size. Okay, so those are the names I have here. Harold Widom, Sterling Barbarian, Donald Ornstein, Hyman Bass, Steve Chase, Wilmer Vasconcelos. So these are various mathematical uncles of mine. Let me show a part of the MacLane letter to the editor. So here's the so-called Kaplansky tree, MacLane letters to the editor, letter to the editor. No, this is 85 issue, 85 November issue, I believe. So it says Kaplansky's introduction to mathematics was much influenced by Richard Brauer, but there is no doubt that he was MacLane's first PhD at Harvard. In his turn, MacLane had followed the usual American tradition, custom of studying at Göttingen. His thesis was written there in 1933 under the direction of Paul Bernays. However, Hitler had dismissed Bernays, so MacLane's doctoral examination was conducted by Hermann Weyl, who found that MacLane could not recall the Hausdorff separation axiom. So I think nowadays we have better graduate students. So MacLane went on to explain the genealogy. So Hermann Weyl's teacher was David Hilbert, and Hilbert's teacher was Ferdinand Lindemann. And then MacLane concluded, we have not pursue the ancestry further. Now, of course, for someone as distinguished as Lindemann, there shouldn't be much difficulty tracking down who his teacher was. And so it was rumored in some quarters that Saunders did not want to go further back in this list, because if he did, then he would have to concede that all these great algebraists would actually come from an analyst, Karl Weierstrass, who I think was the teacher of Lindemann. Okay, so having talked about the Kaplansky tree, let me move on to say a few things about Kaps' very distinguished career. So I tried to put everything on one page, and that wasn't easy, so here's what I came up with. Let me make sure everything is showing. Still not, let's see, so I might have to shift this back and forth a little bit. Okay, so these are Kaps' many. Can I say Kaps many caps or Kaps many hats? These are some of the things that Kaps is very well known by. He was in fact the first Putnam scholar. He was on the 1938 winning team of Toronto on the very first William Putnam exam. And with the Putnam scholarship, he went on to Harvard, and of course went on to become one of the most distinguished algebraists of his generation. As I said, one of Kaps' best accomplishments was that he actually fathered 53 PhD students in Chicago. That must be a record very difficult to match. I know of very few mathematicians who had that many students. Kaps is author of many books, 9 books, many of which I'm very enthused about. I use these books a great deal. And Kaps is not only an author, I would call him a mathematical stylist. He has a very distinctive style of writing, which is difficult to imitate. Never using more words than necessary, he communicates in short, chatty sentences. So the mathematical prose is simple, and yet the messages that he carries are very crisp and compelling. Reading Kaps, you sometimes cannot fail to recognize his style. When you see a passage, you could almost tell that this was written by Kaps. It's almost like listening to say Mozart's music or Bach music. There is some quality which is difficult to describe, but somehow you can pick it up just by reading the writing. These accomplishments and honors of Kaps are very well known, and I certainly don't need to repeat any of them. Of special significance is Kaps' leadership as MSRI director for 8 years, 1984 to 1992. Later speakers will certainly cover this point much better than I could. Let me just move on to the fact that Kaps is an avid swimmer, he is a pianist, singer, and we'll see some of that later in today's festivities. Actually, I want to, having just covered very briefly Kaps' career, I would like to show a few pictures here from more mathematical people. So this is the book written by Don Albers and Gerald Alexanderson. On this cover, we have two and Constance Reed, sorry, Constance. Okay, there are two MSRI directors here, Kaps, and then a little one here. Of course, this is little Bill. When he was a boy. So let me show you some of Kaps' pictures, if Kaps doesn't mind. Here's a family picture of Kaps. Yeah, I will, but let me try to get the picture enlarged a little bit. Is that better? Yeah. So this is Kaps' parents and his siblings, and I believe this is Kaps, and Kaps can correct me if I'm wrong. Kaps is the smallest of a family of 4 children. These are his brothers, and that's his sister. Now, here's another Kaps picture. This is when Kaps finished at the University of Toronto. So that's the year, I guess, when he won the Putnam Scholarship, 1938. And we've got another picture here. This one is when Kaps is Chicago chairman. Picture from the 60s. And then turning the page, we have a very interesting picture of MSRI groundbreaking. So for those who have not seen this picture, this is, of course, a historical event when the groundbreaking took place. And here we have Chern and Kaps and Hyman Bass, Dan Quillen, East Singer. Bob Osterman is standing back here. And I believe this is Martin Kruskal and Reese Harvey. And this is the NSF. Person, L. Thaler. So that's when MSRI was having the groundbreaking ceremony. So of course, at that time, there's no building. So that's 1984, would you say, Kaps? 1984, something like that. So okay, and we have here another picture of two MSRI directors, Chern and Kaps. So and it says here, Kaplansky and Chern discussing a problem. So when two MSRI directors get together to discuss a problem, you must think that it's very high-flung mathematics. But as you zoom in, then you see that they are actually doing a differential equation, it seems. Dz equal to 2y squared dy, and then z is equal to 2/3 of y cubed. And then here, Professor Chern seems to be saying something. Maybe he's saying, Kaps, I think the solution is right, but I also think you have left out a constant here. Okay, so now back to mathematics, and I want to, this is supposed to be a mathematical talk, so I cannot totally discount the importance of our profession. So here is just a summary of the various fields of mathematics to which Kaps has made great contributions. Again, it's very difficult to come up with the list because Kaps has worked in so many areas, so this is what I can come up with. In some sense, in chronological order, but not really, because quite often Kaps would return to an earlier trend of work and then make further contributions. So this is a kind of still fairly randomly arranged list. Fields with valuations, that comes from Kaps' thesis with Saunders in Harvard. This is developing the theory of valuated fields in a sense of Crewe and MacLane. So that's the area in which Kaps wrote his thesis. And then later work, I think this work here was probably influenced by Nathan Jacobson, work on locally compact rings and topological representations of algebra like Stone-Weierstrass theorem, maybe non-Archimedean, things like that. So this is a work that Kaps pursued with Ahrens in UCLA. Rings of operators, this is a very important direction of Kaps' work. So I might want to just say a little bit about that. So here I have, I come back to this transparency here. Let me see if I can turn this on and put it over here for now. And then talk a little bit about these AW star algebras that occupied a part of Kaps' work. So I have this Venn diagram picture here, which kind of summarizes how these different families of algebras relate to one another. So here we have the so-called von Neumann algebras of operators on Hilbert space, and these are the C star algebras. So the C here is supposed to stand for closed, and in fact, the C star algebra is those star algebras in Hilbert space operators that are kind of uniformly closed, closed relative to the uniform topology. And the von Neumann algebras would be those algebras that are, of course, closed under a join, but also closed under the weak operator topology. So that's a subclass of C-star algebras. And the C-star algebras can be exomatized thanks to the work of Gelfand and Neumark. For Neumann algebras, that's more difficult, so let's not get into that. But what Kaps did was to take this class of C-star algebras, which can be exomatized, and he intersected that with a class of objects which is purely algebraically defined, and that's a class of so-called bare star rings. The remarkable thing is that this class is purely algebraically defined. So let me, without giving a very formal definition, let me just recall what a bare star ring is. So first, it's a star ring. So it is a ring that has an involution denoted by star. And the bare here refers to a property called the bare property. That has something to do with annihilators. So the official definition of a bare ring, one that is equipped with star, is this, that any right annihilator is generated by a projection. So by right annihilator, I mean you take any subset of generators in your algebra, and you take the stuff that right annihilates it. So that's called a right annihilator. And you insist that any right annihilator is always generated by a projection. So this is annihilator of any set. So this is S here. Is any set in your operator algebra. This little r means the right annihilator. Any such right annihilator is of the form ER, where E here is an idempotent, so E squared is equal to E, that's idempotent, and E is equal to E star. You want the idempotent here to be constant under the involution star. So that's called projection. Any E that satisfies this equation is called projection. So the bare star ring is a purely algebraic property. It can be defined free of the context of Hilbert space or operators, and that's what's good about it. So you intersect that class with C star algebra, and that's what this class of AW star algebra is about. So Kaps' idea here is to kind of introduce an algebraic formulation of this class here. So this class here, it doesn't really capture all the von Neumann algebras, but it, to some extent it comes close to that. And the point is that you can then use your pure algebra techniques to try to understand the AW star algebra. So Kaps is an algebraist, and so this is to bring the algebraist instinct to bear on the problem. So that's Kaps wrote some very important papers on these AW star algebras. So coming back to this transparency here, so I said something about this. Well, here, now in ring theory, of course, Kaps was very influential in the late 50s when homological algebra was coming to the fore, and he gave very timely lectures in Chicago to introduce generations of students to this topic here. And out of this period came students like Hyman Bass, Steve Chase, Joe Rodman, people like that. So those are students from this period of work. Now, of course, Kaps has a very well-known book here, the Abelian Groups book. And I have it here. It's called The Little Red Book. And I must say that this even predates that of Chairman Mao. Chairman Mao was in the 60s, but this book became famous in the 50s. Actually, what I have here is the revised edition. So that's the one that came out in 69. But the book was written in 54. And in this book here, Kaps gave, I guess it's not showing very well, Kaps gave a masterful introduction to infinite abelian groups, and it has trained generations of students in this subject area. So it's really a very beautiful book. And another important book of Kaps is this one, also revised edition, Commutative Rings. I can say exactly the same for this one here. It has trained generations and generations of students in commutative algebra. Almost anyone learning the subject in the 60s and 70s would be working with this book. So these are some of the most influential works. The book on differential algebra is another very delightful book. It seemed to have grown out from some conversations that Kaps had with Alice Cochin. Alice Cochin was, of course, a great expert on differential algebra, but he didn't write any book in the 50s or 60s, so there was no introduction, and Kaps learned this subject through conversation with Alice Cochin, and he wrote this very delightful book, which is again used by many, many people as a fast and quick introduction to the important field of differential algebra. Kaps also worked with quadratic forms, both over fields and over the integers, and in fact, his latest work in the last couple of years has been on quadratic forms over the integers. He's interested in positive, definite forms that represent a lot of positive values, maybe even all, or all those that are large, or things like that. So that's what Kaps has been working on in the last few years. Infinite dimensional Lie algebras and Lie super algebras, this is a fortunate thing, because just before Kaps became director of the Institute, he actually chaired a program at the Institute on this topic here. That's 84 spring, I believe, before he became director. This topic is, of course, much closer to physics and supersymmetries and things like that. And then besides all these specializations, Kaps also wrote an array, a whole long series of papers on various topics outside of his main line of research. So he wrote papers on number theory, quite a few papers on combinatorics. I think he wrote two papers on game theory, and even a paper on statistics. So one person being able to write on so many things, that's really quite amazing to me. So I intend to talk about some of those things, certainly not all. For one thing, I don't have the expertise to cover so many areas, so I decided to just pick a few nuggets from that. And so I have here a sampling of Kaps results that I propose to talk about. I have listed four things here, but I end up talking for three of them. This one here, earliest and latest. How about some of Kaps' earliest results? Well, you can actually see that from mathematical people. So if you read mathematical people, you see some discussion of the earliest results that Kaps discovered when he was a young boy. So for instance, he was able to figure out at a quite early age that all square integers can end up in certain last digits. He figured that out like fourth grade or something. And then later on, he was able to learn how to solve two linear simultaneous equations all on his own. So there are interesting reports on that in mathematical people, so I don't think I want to repeat that. Latest results, that would be his work on quadratic forms over the integers. I haven't quite caught up with that, so I prefer to talk about some of these other things. Actually, I don't have much difficulty in choosing these particular two, because those are Kaps' own choices from mathematical people. I guess Don Elbers was asking him what results he liked best, and Cap pointed out two of them. One is one that he's proudest of, and the other one is one that he believed was the most referred to. So I would like to talk about two of those, and then I would like to talk about something else, which I call vintage Kaplansky. So let me start with proudest. Now, Kaps, the result that he is proudest of is on continuous geometry. Continuous geometry. Now, so let's explain what a continuous geometry is. That is something that comes from the work of John von Neumann. So a complete lattice with 0 and 1, we start with that. So L is the lattice, and it has two lattice operations. One is the sup, one is the inf. And we assume that there is a smallest element called 0 and a largest element called 1. So that's a lattice. Now, the completeness refers to the fact that you can form the inf and sup not only for one pair of elements, but for an arbitrary family. So you can do sup here. For any family AI, you can do an inf also for an infinite, possibly infinite family of AIs. So that's a complete lattice. It has these infinitary sup inf operations. Now, a modular lattice is one that satisfies the modular law. The modular law is something that is kind of like a weak distributive law. And then there is the concept of complemented. A lattice is called complemented if every element has a complement. Maybe let me zoom this. Doesn't seem to be. Yeah, it doesn't seem to be. The blocking paper? Let me see if I still have the white paper here. Maybe the blue one is not. Yeah, still kind of dark. Yeah. Can you see? Okay. So a complemented lattice is one in which every element has a complement. So for every A in L, there exists an A prime. So A prime is a complement. And complement is in a sense that if you take A sup with A prime, then you get the biggest element. And if you intersect with A prime, then you get the smallest element. So that's a complemented lattice. Turn off the other projector. I think it was working better before. Yeah. I don't know why.
Yeah, if you turn off the other.
Turn off this one? Okay. Yeah. Is it better? Yeah. Okay. Now, so what is a continuous geometry? This is a definition given by John von Neumann. So it's some kind of lattice, in short. And what it is, it's a complete complemented modular lattice, so it has all these properties. And you also impose a continuity axiom. So it has to satisfy two continuity axioms. And a continuity axiom is something like an infinitary distributive law. I don't want to really elaborate on this, but that's really what it is. You have the distributive law, which is usually stated for one operation distributing over two other things, and now you want to distribute over maybe many, many things. And that's where this concept of continuity comes from. So this is a famous definition given by von Neumann. And of course, the motivation of that is, again, from rings of operators, or W star algebra, or von Neumann algebra, as they are known these days. So if you take such a ring of operator on Hilbert space, and you consider all the projections, so they are associated with closed subspaces, and they form a continuous geometry. Projections of various rings of operators would form a continuous geometry. So you need some property on the ring of operators, but given that property, which is some kind of finiteness property, then the projections will actually form one of these complemented, continuous, and complete modular lattices. There are quite a few adjectives to go into that term, but anyway, that's the motivation, right? And what Kapp proved in a paper in the Annals is this simple result here. So it says that if you take a complete modular lattice, L, okay, so it has the completeness property, has infinitary inf and sup operations, it's also modular. Now suppose it's more than just complemented. Suppose it's also complemented. And what that means is that your complement operation, A going to A prime, is just not a randomly associated complement, but rather this is a kind of canonical association that is involutive. So if you do it twice, you should get the element A back. So for every A, you require the complement property to work in such a way that A double prime is equal to A, so that this this prime here is really like an orthogonal projection. So if you take orthogonal projection, take it back, then you get the A back. So it's a little like a canonical complement here. So that's called ortho complemented. Okay. And then what Kaps proved in this Annals paper is that the continuity axiom on the lattice will follow. All you need is to insist that this complement here be ortho complement, has this canonical property, A double prime is equal to A. So this is a very difficult result. Kaps took 20 pages to prove that, and in his other writings, he indicated that he spent about 6 months, 1 year, in working out a proof of that. So it's a very deep theorem, and it's of course impossible to try to explain the proof in a few words, but I try to do my best here. Kaps has about 44 lemmas in that paper. It's really a very long argument, but to give a kind of very quick indication of how it is done, let me just be very brief here. So there is a main case, right? The main case is one where the main ideas work, and then if you're not in this main case, you have to just do something else. So in the main case, the L here, the lattice in question, will look like the lattice L prime of principal right ideals of a von Neumann regular ring. Now, a von Neumann regular ring is an object which is purely algebraic. It is a ring, and it has this von Neumann regularity property, in that for every A, you can write every A here in the form AXA for some X, X depending on A, of course. So this is called von Neumann regularity. So now, given a von Neumann regular ring, you can look at the lattice of principal right ideals. And this is a very important lattice that was initiated by von Neumann. So this L here, in the main case, will be like one of these lattices of principal right ideals of a von Neumann regular ring. And this fact here is called a von Neumann coordinatization theorem. Somehow you coordinatize this arbitrary lattice by using some regular ring. So this is the main case. In many, many cases, this L here will actually look like that. So in that main case, then this R here is a little bit more than just a regular ring. It has a star operation. And the star operation would come from the fact that the complementation here is also complemented, right? So this A prime here is really like an involution. So this involution here would induce a star operation on the coordinatizing von Neumann regular ring. So the von Neumann regular ring here would be a star ring. Regular here just refers to von Neumann regular, and there is a little bit on top of that. So, but anyway, this R here is a purely algebraic object which is called a star regular ring. And then Kaps' idea is that you prove enough about this star regular ring to conclude that this L prime here, the lattice of principal right ideals, is actually continuous. So that's a very backbone description of the proof, but it's very long and it's a very deep theorem. So, so Kaps seems to be proudest of this particular theorem here. Let me move on to the result that is called most referred to. This is a result to do with rings with polynomial identities. So PI here stands for polynomial identity. So let me try to explain the idea of rings with polynomial identities. Now, the simplest case of a polynomial identity is a commutative F algebra. F here is a field, so take any field, and if an algebra, F algebra, is commutative, then xy is equal to yx, so of course it satisfies this identity, xy is equal to yx, right? Or xy minus yx is equal to zero. So that's a class of PI rings, a ring that satisfies identity in polynomial in its in variables. And now another case of PI algebra is this algebra here, which is called the generalized quaternion algebra. Now, generalized quaternion algebra is one that extends the usual quaternion algebra. So here you take a field F, and you take, let's say the field is not characteristic 2, and you take AB here, which are non-zero elements in the field. And what you do here is to imitate the Hamiltonian formation of the usual quaternion algebra. So you form an F algebra with four basis elements, one I, j, k, and then your relations are just those imitating Hamilton, except that instead of minus one, you put a and b, which can be arbitrary non-zero elements. So I squared is equal to a, j squared is equal to b, I and J anti-commute, and K is defined to be I times J. And this is a four-dimensional algebra whose center is exactly equal to F. And if you want to get back the usual quaternion algebra, then you just take the reals here and you put AB to be both minus 1. Then you'll be back to the Hamiltonian algebra. Now, for XY in A, XY minus YX is a pure quaternion. A pure quaternion is a quaternion that has no constant term. So this can be checked by direct calculation. You just take any two quaternions, do this additive commutator, and just note that there is no constant term. So it's a pure quaternion. And as a pure quaternion, when you square it, then you would get a scalar. See, when you take a pure quaternion, there is no constant term, ijk. When you square it, the cross terms will all cancel out because the ijks are pairwise commuting. So then you just end up with a constant. So the square of a pure quaternion is in F. And since F is in the center, then the A here will satisfy this polynomial identity expressing the fact that xy minus yx quantity square will be central. It will commute with every single z, right? So this is a polynomial identity satisfied by a generalized quaternion algebra. And note that this one here is of degree 5. 4 degree here, 1 additional degree. That's 5. Now in 1943, Marshall Hall proved a very remarkable theorem, and that concerns a division algebra over F. Let's say F is the center of this division algebra. To begin with, you don't impose any dimension assumption. So the dimension can be infinite to begin with. You just have a division algebra with center F, any dimension. Marshall Hall proved that if A here satisfies this particular polynomial identity, then a very strong conclusion, either A would be already equal to F, or else it would be one of these generalized quaternion algebra. So that's a quite remarkable result. And Kaps took this result, and in a few years, he came up with a fantastic generalization of this result here. So this is a 1948 theorem of Kaps. And it applies to the class of simple algebras. Simple algebra is one that has only the zero and the whole thing as an ideal. Actually, the theorem is good for what is called primitive algebra, but we don't want to go into a more technical definition. So simple algebra is something that is more easily recognized. So let me state Kaps' theorem here for a simple algebra. Now, of course, you can take a division algebra. That's certainly a simple algebra. So if you take a simple algebra with center F, again, with any dimension, no dimension restriction, if this A here satisfies the PI, polynomial identity, say of degree D, then the dimension must be finite. Dimension A must be finite, and it would be bounded by this. Now, Kaps would no doubt tell me that I'm stating a little bit more than what he stated in the paper, because what he stated in the paper is just that the dimension A be finite with no bound here. And what happens is that a few years later, Amitsur and Levitsky discover some identities on matrix algebras. And if you combine Kaps' results with those results of Amitsur and Levitsky on identities on matrix algebras, then you would automatically get this bound here. So I may as well throw in this part here, although for those who search the literature, you see that this bound was not stated in Kaps' work. But if you just anticipate the Amitsur-Levitsky result, then this bound here will be there. Now, it's interesting to compare this bound with what goes on here. To state this bound, actually a better way is to take the square root here. Put the square root over here. The square root of the dimension is less than or equal to d over 2. In fact, it is known that for finite dimensional simple algebra, the dimension over the center is always a perfect square. So it's good to put a square root here. So this bound here really tells you that the square root of the dimension is less than or equal to half of the degree of any polynomial identity that it satisfies. So if you come back to this case here, that's a 5-degree polynomial. So the dimension square root would be bounded by 5 over 2, 2.5 square. So that would make the dimension less than or equal to 4. And that's why you end up with the quaternion algebra and whole algebra, right? So although I'm overstating the result a little bit, but this part here would be implicit in Kaps' result if you just anticipate the Amitsur results. Now, this work of Kaps is really a trailblazing kind of result. It virtually opened a floodgate to the investigation of algebras satisfying polynomial identities. Before Kaps' work, there was really very little done. And once Kaps' paper appeared, then the activities intensified, and there were many, many papers written on the subject since then. And this field here has now become a very important part of non-commutative algebra, and it seems to also play a role in the so-called non-commutative geometry that is developing these days. So this paper is no doubt the most referred to, because almost anyone writing on rings with polynomial identities would almost definitely refer to Kaps' work here, this being the first result that kind of opened up the whole field. So that's a very influential work of Kaplansky. And the last one I want to talk about is what I call vintage Kaplansky. This is a result that I particularly like. And this is on projective modules, on projective modules. Kaps' result on projective modules. Now, so projective modules are direct summands of three modules. It's really difficult to read. Let me just zoom in a little bit more here. OK. So projective modules are defined to be direct summands of three modules. And different people think in different terms here. The geometers would think of a vector bundle, and algebraists would think of an idempotent, either in a ring itself or in some kind of matrix ring. And the analysts would perhaps call them projections. So these are just various disguises of projective modules. Now, Z is atypical. If you look at Z, the projectives are free, so there isn't much stuff to look at. But then over rings of algebraic integers, that is already not the case. So for instance, over Z square root of minus 5, you take ideals in this ring, then since the ring is a Dedekind ring, the ideals are all projective, but then generally they are free. They are not free unless they are principal ideals. So projective modules really exist and are very interesting. And if you think in terms of idempotents here, I here wrote down a particular example. This particular matrix over that ring, as you can check, it is an idempotent. You square this matrix here, you get the matrix itself. But the module defined by this matrix, say by taking the image, thinking of the idempotent as a projection, you take the image, then this image here is not free. Because if it is free, then this matrix here can be transformed by similarity transformation into this one. And if you really try, you can see that you cannot do that. So again, this idempotent here is kind of a very non-trivial idempotent. It doesn't give you a free module, but it gives you a projective module. So that's where the idea comes from. There are these interesting objects. Now, over a local ring, so local ring is a ring in which all units, all non-units, form an ideal. You take all non-units and there is an ideal right there. The simplest example would be out of the rationals, you take any integer over odd integers, you take the totality of these, that's a local ring. And it was perhaps in the famous homological algebra text of Kaktong-Eilenberg that you find this result here, that over any local ring, finitely generated projectives are free. Finitely generated projective modules are free. This is a very famous result. Not difficult to prove. You just go modulo the maximal ideal, find a basis there, and you pull back. It's a very simple proof. The catch is finitely generated. So the question arises, what if the module, projective module is not finitely generated? And Kaps proved this theorem here that the Kaktong-Eilenberg statement is actually true for all projectives. So over any local ring, all projectives are in fact free. All projectives are free. In fact, Kaps proved much more. So he proved a result here which not only works for local rings, but in fact works for any ring. So this is a very general result here. So over any ring, here's what Kaps proved. Suppose you consider direct sums of countably generated modules. So these modules are fairly general, right? Countably generated. They can be finitely generated or can be generated by a countable sequence of elements. So you take a direct sum of such countably generated modules. Suppose you have a direct sum man, X, sitting in this direct sum of countably generated modules. Then Kaps' conclusion is that this X here also looks like that. This X here itself can be broken up into a direct sum of countably generated modules. Right. This is one of Kaps' most interesting theorems. Now, when you apply this to projective modules, then you do the following. Suppose here you take a direct sum of the ring itself. So the ring itself is generated by one element, so certainly that's countably generated. And so here you can put any free module, right? because any free module is a direct sum of copies of the ring. So this result would tell you that any projective module that is a direct sum band of a free module is automatically a direct sum of countably generated modules. So this is amazing because it's because of its generality. It works for any ring and it works for any projective module. Any projective module is always breakable into a direct sum of countably generated ones. So now if you take theorem 2 and try to apply that to theorem 1, then theorem 1 is right away reduced to the countably generated case, right? Because you try to prove that any projective is free, so take any typical projective, then it suffices to prove that any of these direct sum bands is free. And then you're down to the countably generated case, right? So Kaps make a reduction to the countably generated case. And then in a countably generated case, he really made good use of countable generation to prove the theorem, the freeness of the module by another clever argument. So it's a combination of theorem 2 and then an ad hoc argument to handle these countably infinite modules. Now, the reason I call this result vintage Kaplansky is that this paper really displayed several very special qualities of Kaps as a mathematician. First, it is Kaps' genius in doing what he called infinite algebra. See, much of this is infinite stuff here. I might call this the taming of the infinite. So somehow, in the hands of Kaplansky, the infinite seemed more accessible or more manageable. He has a great skill in handling these infinite things. And second, it is Kaps' conviction that mathematics is not just what you prove, but also how you prove it. The best kind of proof is the kind that not only gives us a conclusion, but one that gives you a relation or a structure, right? And so this may be the result, and this one is the one that gives you the true insight. So often, this kind of mathematics occurs in Kaps' work and also occurs in the work of his teacher, MacLane. Certainly, we feel here the deep influence of Emmy Noether, because it was she who first taught us to think in structural terms in abstract algebra. So this is a very typical Kaplansky mathematical work. Now, Kaps himself said in an afterthought on this paper that he was amazed that his results were not done long ago, but I hold the opposite view. I don't think anyone could have gotten this result here but Kaps himself. It is just something that you can learn from Kaps, but he would be the one to really come up with such an argument. So I think we have done enough mathematics here, so let me now just go back and I would just show you some quotations from Kaps. So Kaps has made various pieces of advice which can be found in his writings and in various interviews that he had with people. So I picked out three particular advices for the young that Kaps had for us. The first one is a paraphrase of Gauss, according to Kaps. It says, publish little, but make it good. The second one here is do examples. Do a million examples. I think there are shameful cases of people making silly and reckless conjectures just because they didn't take the trouble to look at the first few examples. So I think this one is good advice. One last one here. Spend some time every day learning something new that is disjoint from the problem on which you are currently working. Remember that disjointness may be temporary and read the masters. So these are some of Kaps' good advices that you should all take to heart. And I would like to show you here some quotable quotes from Kaps. The first one is on generalizations. So Kaps said, no mathematician of this century is immune from this disease. on his famous AW star algebras that I tried to explain, André Weil once thanked me for naming a class of algebras after him. Of course, he was well aware that the letter A simply stands for abstract. This is supposed to be abstract W star algebra, but it's also abstract Weil algebra, I guess, or André Weil algebras. Now, André Weil himself, this is from an interview Kaps had with Louis Hermann. Hermann. And Andre Weil was an impressive mathematician. Cap, I would say he's the second smartest person I ever knew. So that obviously invites a question. Hermann, you're not going to say who is the first. Cap, no, I certainly will. It was John von Neumann. Number two, Andre Weil. So it's good to know that Andre Weil can sometimes be number two. But since von Neumann is now long deceased, I think Andre Weil is still number one, perhaps. So just a couple more quotations here from Kapp on conjectures. So Kapp said, well, we are all cut from the same cloth. When a proposed theorem turns out to be true, we bask when credited with conjecturing it. When the opposite happens, we protest that we merely raise the question. So that's why I call Kapp a mathematical stylist. Yeah, that's right. I omitted that part. If you get away with it, right? Yeah, it's part of the sentence. That's what this daughter thought here. Sorry about that. And so now I want to quote something else that someone else said. This is on Kaplansky's density theorem. Kapp once proved a theorem about denseness of spheres in operator algebras. You have two operator algebras, and he relates the denseness of a unit sphere in one operator algebra to the other one. So that theorem is called Kaplansky's density theorem. It's an important theorem, although since I'm algebraic, I don't use it so often. But I think for operator algebra people, it's a very fundamental theorem. So the operator theorist, Gerd Pedersen, said the following on Kaplansky's density theorem. Gerd Pedersen, the density theorem is Kaplansky's greatest gift to mankind. It can be used every day and twice on Sundays. So, obviously flattered, Kapp remarked, Gerd Pedersen is equally witty in real life. So, in conclusion, I would like to say the following to Kapp. So, for all the mathematics you have taught us, for the great services and superb leadership that you have rendered to the mathematical community, and above all, for the personal model of perfection and integrity you have set throughout your career, we are and will forever be grateful. Happy 80th birthday, Kapp.
He's been writing songs, writing parodies, and playing them for many, many years. And so we're very happy he agreed today to play some of his songs. And so I'd like to introduce Kapp for song playing and merriment.
How long should I take? How long should I take?
Not more than a half hour, an hour.
Some general remarks. Thanks to the organizers. Thanks to the four deputy directors who expressed such pleasant things. And to Lab for a fantastic look into. I felt that he had entered my brain and pulled it out and exhibited to you. And to Saunders for a fabulous poem. In the middle of this bookkeeping, I do want to acknowledge that Paul Chernoff, David Eisenbund, John Selfridge, Paul Halmos, and Robin Hartshorn took the trouble to send me messages in absente. A few words as I look back. My goodness, I've been lucky. My undergraduate years at Toronto were a pleasure. My years at Harvard with a firm but gentle and firm as needed, gentle also as needed direction of my thesis. 39 happy years at the University of Chicago. surmounted by 8 happy years as director of MSRI. And then the new management was kind enough to allow me to hang around. I will tell you this, that at that point, I changed my field. I became a number theorist. And in fact, for the 4.5 years since my retirement as MSRI director, I've been spending most of my time on just one problem. One thing that pleases, a number of things please me as I stand here talking to you about that. The problem was posed by Dixon, Leonard Eugene Dixon, giant figure. I think Lam mentioned him at the University of Chicago. When he taught number theory in the summer of 1938, I was one of the students. I spent that summer in Chicago not seeking a degree. It kind of be a pleasant thought if somehow or other he could realize that one of the students in that class, almost 70 years later, settled a question that he had posed. Now, Bob Osterman told you in general terms what the problem was. Some Turing reforms behave well, others behave badly. It's been known for 30 years that the number that behave well is finite. Therefore, they can be listed. There's a paper with the title, "There are 913 regular Turing reforms." And just before my 80th birthday, that paper has been accepted. It will appear in Mathematica. Mathematica with a K. That's the journal where G.L. Watson. Saunders, did you ever meet G.L. Watson? Anyway, it's dedicated to him because the ideas were largely his. I have 2 co-authors in that paper. One is Will Jagie, already mentioned. And there he is in the audience. And the other is Alexander Schiemann, a very bright young German number theorist at the Universität des Saarlandes. I estimate that thousands of computer hours went into the, also some thinking. The computing facilities that I had available at MSRI were perfect for the purpose, thanks to Joe Christie and his wonderful staff. Joe, are you here? The kindness and help you have shown to me through these 4.5 years have blossomed into a paper that I think is worthwhile. Well, for years, ever since coming here, I've hammed up the Christmas parties and sometimes other occasions by allegedly entertaining. And all right, I'm going to do it again. I didn't want to just repeat the old songs, which I've done several times. I got a new one. The well is not run completely dry. This is a parody. The parody was suggested. Now, there's a throwaway in the East Bay called Express. It covers events in the East Bay and so on. But they also cover events in San Francisco a little bit. And recently, they instituted a column called Over There. And under that, they put what's going on, which is in San Francisco, which might be interesting. Well, that planted a seed in my mind. There is a song over there. Maybe some of you even are slightly familiar with it. It's a World War I song by George M. Cohan. Now, I think a parody is more fun when you know the original. I probably don't have the words quite right. Forgive me for that. Something like, over there, send the word over there, that the Yanks are coming, the drums rum-tumming everywhere, so beware, have a care, send the word over there, we'll be over, we're coming over, and we won't come back till it's over, over there. The parody. Thank you. I never checked it out. Over there, It's not often I go over there, for the bridge is tremendous, the toll is stupendous, the traffic's a nightmare over there. I see Constance Reed right in front of me, who lives in San Francisco, forgive me. So beware, have a care, you'll go broke if you park over there. You take the West Bay, I'll keep the East Bay, and I won't go back till it changes over there. First time performed anywhere. Ever, probably the last. Well, I'm now going to in my list of credits for people I'm grateful to, my family, including my wife, who is sitting right here. And we have three kids, and the youngest one, Lucy, performs. She sometimes comes to Berkeley and performs at Freight and Salvage. And in recent performances, she has been doing two of my songs. And I am told, well, actually, I even saw it once or twice, that they amuse the audience a little bit. Therefore, I will plug my daughter, Lucy, and do these two songs for you. They are On an Asteroid with You and The Song About Pi. A little bit about On an Asteroid with You. It was written on our honeymoon in 1951. Space travel was very much in the air at the time. And it occurred to me that sometime in the future it might be possible to buy a whole asteroid and put up a cottage for two there, make it your second home. Out popped the words and music of On an Asteroid with You, just like that. So here it goes. By the way, there was something in the papers not too long ago that trips to the asteroids were being discussed by NASA. Honest and truly. And then there's recent publicity about maybe an asteroid's going to hit the Earth. So it's in the air. When I first get a chance for an interstellar romance on a rocket ship that's built for two, I'll go sailing through space from this tired old place to an asteroid with you. As our fuel tanks blast, we'll forget all the past till we hit escape velocity. Then the planet will yield its gravitational field. We'll be in a flight that's free. We'll be in a state of possessing no weight. At least that's how the theory goes. And I feel like reminding you at this point that in 1951, no one had yet been in space and experienced weightlessness. Therefore, at least that's how the theory goes. And you won't need any brand new clothes, very important, 'cause you'll look so cute in your little space suit. The theory of space suits was well understood at the time, but of course one had not yet been used in space travel. In fact, old science fiction magazines, they had it quite right, they showed space suits. Well, there was an old joke that when they put a space suit on the cover, it was a lovely young lady, of course. I'm in trouble. And it was mostly space, very little suit. We'll go sailing by Mars, past the curtain of stars, and we'll pause to pitch a little woo. I believe the phrase pitch a little woo is no longer known, but maybe you can guess it from context. As our fuel gives out, we'll arrive with a shout on an asteroid for two. Now, I've done the song about Pi several times here, and I think it was found tolerably amusing. But I never had the opportunity, the time, or I felt it was right to explain why and how this song was written. And gol darn it, I'm going to do it. I'll try to make it as short as possible, but I've got to give you a little lecture, I really have to, about the forms in which the popular songs, now the songs I'm talking about are not the current ones, they don't fit what I'm about to say, but let us say from 1920 to 1950, something like that. Most of those songs have the form, we got a little lecture coming up, so I will use the blackboard. Should have erased it first. Most songs have the form A, A, B, A. A is typically an 8-bar phrase in the usual way the bars are divided, repeated. Then a contrasting B theme. Musicians call it the release or the bridge, and then back to the A. I think I ought to give you an illustration of that. And I'm picking the Gershwin's song, Lady Be Good. Now, that's a much admired song, and yet it illustrates my point. AABA has the potential of being monotonous. You're hearing the A music three times. And in the song, Lady Be Good, those three repetitions are absolutely identical, not in lyrics, but in music. George Gershwin wrote the very same 8 bars for the three appearances of A. Ah, trivial question. Name a song of that era for which even the lyrics are the same in the three A's. We can discuss that later if you like such questions. I know two such songs. I'm going to play Lady Be Good, and I'm going to murder it. I'm going to make the following point. Suppose you play two choruses. Then you'll be doing AABA, and then again AABA. And then you'll have three A's in a row. And in this song, they'll be absolutely identical. Now, I'm going to play the song in a rather wooden way, which is a shameful thing to do, but here goes. Here comes the B. Back to A. Now I'm going to do a second chorus right ahead. So A. A again. At this point, I've lost count, but I think I did three A's in a row, and it's getting monotonous. Another trouble with this AABA is you hear the A thing three times and the B thing only once. There are any number of songs where I have forgotten the release. I have forgotten the B music. Maybe I'll never recapture it because you don't hear it enough compared to the incessant repetition of the A music. Well, I will erase AABA. There is a second form. And there's a little something I'll say about it. Well, I'll say several things. The first thing I'm going to say is, well, first thing I'm going to do is put it up. It's different. A prime, B. A prime, B over 2, A double prime. A is typically a 4-bar phrase in a 32-bar song. A prime is a variant. B is new material, 8 bars. A prime, half of B, B over 2. Then A comes back for a final appearance, changed again, A double prime. I remember while playing in a dance band in my high school years, the band played the long-forgotten song, Little Girl. I wonder, there's not a chance that anybody in the audience knows Little Girl. But I very clearly remember thinking, do you know Linda? Hey, this is not an AABA. It's something different. Well, years and years and years passed. I thought not too much about it. There's an applied mathematician in Chicago named Bob Ashenhurst. I happened to mention it to him once. And he said, hey, I never thought of that. Explain that further. And I told him about this form and showed him several songs that match it. So he was quite taken with it. And we had many lively discussions. And we still continue corresponding about it. Now, I hear my state, and I find it incredible. As far as I know, nobody on this planet has ever noticed this second form. I call it Type 2 in honor of rigs of operators. I'm going to do a type, of course, the song about pi is a type 2. But before we come to that, got to watch the time, I'm going to do my favorite type 2 song for you. It's not a well-known song, but I like it. And it really is a very good song for illustrating this form. By the way, for music theorists, there's a vague resemblance here to sonata form. First theme, second theme, no development. Recapitulation, second theme shortened, coda. This song is Dolores. It's by Lou Alter, 1941. I regret that I don't know who wrote the lyrics. I'm going to play it. Frank Lesser wrote the lyrics? Yeah. I won't introduce you yet. Let's go over that again, and I'll count the bars. One, two, three, four. Four bars, that's the A music. It's a little different, just a tiny bit different. Very similar, though. So that's A prime. We record the difference by a mathematical symbol. Three, four, five, six, seven, eight. Those eight bars are the B music. A repeated verbatim. A prime repeated verbatim. That's the first half of B, not quite verbatim. That last note went up an octave, but good enough. That's unmistakably the A music, but again, a little different. A double prime, forming a nice conclusion to the song. I think you ought to hear the lyrics of this song. But once more, with lyrics. Don't fail to notice the cute internal rhymes. Frank Lesser. How I love the kisses of Dolores. Aye, 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 Dolores. Not Marie or Emily or Doris. Only my Dolores. From a balcony above me, she whispers love me and throws a rose. Ah, but she is twice as lovely as the rose she throws. I would die to be with my Dolores. Aye, 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 Dolores. Lips. I murdered the lyrics. There was not a repetition there. But I'll continue. Lips were made to serenade Dolores. Chorus after chorus. Just imagine eyes like moonrise, and cheeks like roses, and lips like wine. What a break if I could make Dolores. One reason I'm doing the lyrics for you, I find it very amusing. What a break if I could make Dolores. Pause. After that. Mine, oh my. Well, Bob Ashenders and I got so excited about this type 2 thing. I repeat the incredible belief that No one has noticed this except me. This is in the literature twice now. In More Mathematical People, I got a chance to talk a bit about it. In a book by the late Gerald Mast, professor of English, I believe, at the University of Chicago, and the approximate title of the book is The American Musical Comedy, there's a page about it, and attributed to me. So musical scholars can debate this for centuries to come. It's in the literature. In 1972, on an invitation to entertain the students at one of the dorms in Chicago, I worked up a full-size talk. It ran every bit of an hour, giving many, many illustrations. By the way, one thing I at least want to say is there are lots of other Type 2 songs, and the great composers all had a hand in it. Gershwin, Embraceable You. Rodgers and Hart, I especially like Thou Swell. Jerome Kern, Who? Irving Berlin, Always, and so on. I once made a count of 100 songs picked at random. 70 were AABA, 20 were Type 2, and 10 were other forms or irregular. So AABA dominates, but there's a substantial segment of Type 2. Anyway, for this talk, I decided that the climax would be to take the decimal expansion of pi, make a tune of it. How do you do that? 3141592653589793. That's the first 14 digits of pi. Fortunately, there's no zero. I'm not sure what I would have done with a zero, but with 1 to 9, no problem. Not very promising musical material. And the point that I made in that talk, and I'm making again to you, is that Type 2 is so much better than AABA. Type 2 flows sweetly and smoothly from beginning to end. There's no chance of forgetting a release. If you start a Type 2 song at all, you're going to get through it to the end, because there's no part of it that will be conceivably forgotten. Well, there's this terrible theme, but if you put a little rhythm and a little harmony to it. Passable, maybe. That's A. For A prime, I dropped 1/3. That's one of the things that sometimes happens in passing from A to A prime, not in the song Dolores, but Cole Porter's You're the Top is a very good example, where the A drops 1/3 to A prime. So I dropped 1/3. Well, I'm not using any more of pi. When we come to the B music, I just invented something. That's the B music, A. A prime. Well, now, that's not really B over 2. All right, we can allow occasional exceptions. In this song, the B over 2 happens to be new material. It's all right. Well, this is certainly A double prime. That A double prime in some Type 2 songs is a recapitulation of the lyrics and not of the music. But in my theory of this business, there must be such a final echo, a final recollection, or it can't be called a Type 2 song. It rather suggests to me, you know, in a musical comedy, there's often a hit song, unmistakably a hit song, and the audience gets to like it so much, they have to hear it one more time at the end. They recapitulate it one final time. So the A music is so pretty, you got to hear it one more time as A double prime. So that's the song about pi. Enid Reeser, a student advisor at the University of Chicago, was in the audience, and she came to me a few days later. She had written lyrics for it. These are her lyrics. Oh, and later on, I wrote a verse. I added a verse, words and music. You don't know what a verse is. One of the things you're about to learn is what a verse is. In the olden days, nearly every song had a verse. The verse wasn't very catchy, very hard to remember the verse, but it works out nicely. When performed in a musical comedy, they do things on the stage. The chorus comes in to get ready to dance, or something in order that goes on, and you get through the verse, and then comes the chorus that everybody wants to hear. So here's the verse I wrote. In all the bygone ages, philosophers and sages have meditated on the circle's mysteries. From Euclid to Pythagoras, from Gauss to Anaxagoras, their thoughts have filled the libraries, bulging histories. And yet there was elation throughout the whole Greek nation when Archimedes did his mighty computation. In case you don't know it, Archimedes was the first one to rigorously compute a value of pi to a considerable accuracy. He said, 3, 1, 4, oh my, here's a song to sing about pi. Not a sigma or mu, but a well-known Greek letter too. You can have your alphas and the great phi bates and omega for a friend. But that's just what a circle doesn't have, a beginning or an end. 3, 1, 4, 1, 5, 9 is a ratio we don't define. I asked Mrs. Reeser, what the hell does that mean? Well, after some discussion, we agreed that it means that pi is irrational, not the ratio of two integers, first proved by Lambert in 1735. Of course, the much better theorem that it's actually transcendental was proved by Lindemann, my academic great-great-great-grandfather, in 1882. 3, 1, 4, 1, 5, 9 is a ratio we don't define. 2 pi times radii get circumference you can rely. If you square the radius times the pi, you will get the circle space. Here's a song about pi, fit for a mathematician's embrace. I promise to keep the half an hour like this.
Well, that was really great. Thank you very, very, very much. We had this incredible list of Kaps PhD students and their students and their students and so on unto the many generations. But that's just PhD students. Nobody has mentioned the fact that for, 39 years at Chicago, Kap taught all kinds of courses, including undergraduates and early at Harvard also. And when you think of all the various students who have been in all his various courses, the degree of the influence is a little bit mind-boggling. But at any rate, one of those students we thought would be good to bring here for the musical part of our festivities. And so I'd like to introduce Tom Lehrer.
What is this? Okay. I hope you can hear this over the piano.
I can certainly hear it. That's great.
Okay. I don't know if you know this.
Cap's actual birthday is March 22nd. And that's the same day as the birthday of Stephen Sondheim, Andrew Lloyd Webber, and Richard Wagner. I hope you astrologers will have fun with that one. Anyway, yeah, so, I guess I can see over this. That's fine. So Bob Osterman called me to see if I would dig out some of the old math songs from the old days. So I came up with 4 and one more recent one. I first intersected with Kap in the summer of 1943. I took 2 courses from him at Harvard. He was then, it was 54 years ago, so he would have been 26, and I was 4. And one of them was algebra, which, as I recall, I may be wrong, but I don't think you could call it algebra then because that was like a high school subject, like civics. But they called it higher algebra or, in the case of Berkhoff and MacLane, modern algebra. So I think now they have postmodern algebra, I think. But I haven't kept up with that. So anyway, that didn't lead to any songs. For one thing, nothing rhymes with algebra, does it? Is there anything that rhymes with algebra? I've never been able to find one, but there's a challenge. Think about that tonight. But the other one was freshman calculus. And that did lead to a song, which is here somewhere. It was set to a tune which, fortuitously enough, is this is the definition of the derivative. And the tune, fortuitously enough, is called There'll Be Some Changes Made, 1923. Take a function of x and you call it y. Take any x naught that you care to try. You make a little change and call it delta x. The corresponding change in y is what you find next. And then you take the quotient and now carefully send delta x to zero, and I think you'll see that what the limit gives us if our work all checks is what we call dy dx. It's just dy dx. Okay, so it all wasn't working. Then, a little later, we got more sophisticated and got into deltas and epsilons. And so here's that prompted another song called There's a Delta for Is this? Yeah, well, it varies a lot when I move my head. What should I do? Sing like that? All right, I'll try and keep my head down. This is called There's a Delta for Every Epsilon. It's a political song. There's a delta for every epsilon. It's a fact that you can always count upon. There's a delta for every epsilon. And now and again, there's also an N. But one condition I must give, the epsilon must be positive. A lonely life, all the others live in no theorem, a delta for them. How sad, how cruel, how tragic, how pitiful and other agic, tivs that I might mention. The matter merits our attention. If an epsilon is a hero, just because he is greater than zero, it must be mighty discouraging to lie to the left of the origin. This rank discrimination is not for us. We must fight for an enlightened calculus where epsilons, all both minus and plus, have deltas to call their own. Okay. Then, a bunch of us at Harvard, when I was a graduate student, did a show called The Physical Review. It was supposed to be the last class of an elementary physics lecture, and the professor played himself. I changed the words a little bit to fit mathematics, not much. I suppose nowadays when people think of Harvard and mathematics, they naturally think of Ted Kaczynski. But in those days, okay, this tune for this, if there's any non-Gilbert and Sullivan buffs here, the tune is King Gama's song from Princess Ida by Gilbert and Sullivan. If you give me your attention, I will tell you what I am. I'm a brilliant mathematician, also something of a ham. I've tried for numerous degrees. In fact, I've one of each. Of course, that makes me eminently qualified to teach. I understand the subject matter thoroughly, it's true, and I can't see why it isn't all as obvious to you. Each lecture is a masterpiece, meticulously planned, yet everybody tells me that I'm hard to understand, and I can't think why. My diagrams are models of true art, you must agree, and my handwriting is famous for its legibility. Take a word like, I gotta do this, minimum. It's one of my favorite words to write on the blackboard. Problem, find the Fourier series. Okay, where was I? Take a word like minimum to choose a random word. For anyone to say he cannot read that is absurd. The anecdotes I tell get more amusing every year, though frankly, what they go to prove is sometimes less than clear. And all my explanations are quite lucid, I am sure, yet everybody tells me that my lectures are obscure, and I can't think why. For example, take differentiation, it's as simple as can be. like finding the derivative of tangent x. Let's see. It's tangent squared. No, secant squared. No, it's just secant, I'll bet. The sign in front is plus, or is it minus? I forget. Well, it does have a derivative. Of that, there is no doubt. All these formulas are trivial if you only think them out. Yet students tell me I have memorized the whole term through. Everything you've taught us, but the problems I can't do, and I can't think why. He can't think why. That's it. Yeah. Okay. What's the next one? Oh, yeah. Well, for 9 years, I taught in the political science department at MIT, believe it or not, teaching the quantitative courses. Those were the days of mathematical models and statistics. Those were the days, I think it still is true, when social science was trying very hard to justify the word science. One of the ways you do that is by introducing jargon, which nobody can understand. You know, if this young man expresses himself in terms too deep for me, then what a singularly deep young man this deep young man must be. And the other is to use mathematics. And that's what they were trying to do. And I think there's still people who are laboring under this delusion in social sciences. Anyway, that you can make it into a science. However, so I wrote this song, it's a parody called Sociology. Now, MIT did not have a sociology department. They hadn't sunk that low. But sociology was included in political science. And that was a better title for a song. So this is a song about that phenomenon of trying to mathematicize social science. It's called Sociology. The tune is a song called Choreography, which was sung by Danny Kaye in a movie called White Christmas by Irving Berlin. Strange is the change they are trying to arrange today in sociology. Fanatics in their attics are learning mathematics just for sociology. Persuasion by equation they all feel is much more satisfactory. They in an ivory steeple far away from all people, they do research in sociology. Guys who wrote lies now present them in disguise, a cinch in sociology. Attract, quite abstract, without one single fact, is splendid sociology. Birds, who used words, now all talk in terms of X and Y and Z. They can take one small matrix and really do great tricks, all in the name of sociology. Joes, who wrote prose, now write algebra. Who knows? It may be sociology. There, everywhere, full of sigma and chi-square and full of sociology, they consult, sounding occult, talking like a mathematics PhD. They can snow all their clients by calling it science. Although it's only sociology. Okay, now what else do I have? One more here, found in the files. Oh, this is a fairly recent one, actually. A number of years ago, the Children's Television Workshop decided to have a program to teach math to little kids, and it was going to be called That's Mathematics, and I wrote a song for it. They changed the title, however, to Square One TV, and they didn't use the song. So it went back in the trunk, and then 1993 for the Fermat Bacchanal here, Bob called me and I said, do you have anything? And I dug this song out, and they wouldn't allow us to use the tune, which was to the song called That's Entertainment by Arthur Schwartz and Howard Deeds. So I had to write another tune, and I also added a little verse about Andrew Wiles to make it appropriate, called That's Mathematics. It's for little kids, remember, except for the Andrew Wiles part. Counting sheep when you're trying to sleep, being fair when there's something to share, being neat when you're folding a sheet. That that's mathematics. When a ball bounces off of a wall, when you cook from a recipe book, when you know how much money you owe, that's mathematics. How much gold can you hold in an elephant's ear? When it's noon on the moon, then what time is it here? If you could count for a year, would you get to infinity or somewhere in that vicinity? Oh, and you choose how much postage to use when you know what's the chance it will snow, when you bet and you end up in debt. Oh, try as you may, you just can't get away from mathematics. Andrew Wiles gently smiles, does his thing, and voila, QED, we agree, and we all shout hurrah, as he confirms what Fermat jotted down in that margin, which could have used some enlarging. Tap your feet, keeping time to the beat of a song, while you're singing along, harmonize with the rest of the guys. Yes, try as you may, you just can't get away from mathematics. Thank you.
All right.
Well, thank you, Tom, and thank you, Cap. It's a little hard for me to figure out what we're going to do to top this for the 90th, but at any rate, I hope you all enjoyed it today, and thanks a lot for coming. Bye. Well, we have one additional special event for CAP's 80th birthday celebration, and that is Saunders MacLane is going to give us a song, and he will explain exactly what it's about. Saunders.
So, in my youth, I grew up in New England and greatly admired T.S. Eliot, and when I discovered I couldn't write any poetry at the level of Prufrock, I gave up and started in mathematics and reduced to category theory. So sometime in the distant past, I learned from some eminent professor at UCLA a certain song about Riemann. So here it goes. Here's to the zeros of Zeta of S. G. Bernard Riemann has made a good guess. They're all on the critical line, said he, and their density's 1 over 2 pi log t. This conjecture of Riemann has got them all started. But many good land from this life has departed without ascertaining with suitable rigor what happens to zeta when log t gets bigger.